San Francisco Greater Bay Area in 1968, before the American Indian Movement. We were involved in the takeover of Alcatraz, Wounded Knee, a couple long walks across country. We led a group one time that took over Mount Rushmore and reclaimed it for my nation, the Lakota Nation. Now, being an enrolled citizen of a sovereign nation, be it the Lakota Nation, I want to bring something to the forefront right now as far as tribal identity and what it means to be a recognized, legitimate citizen of a tribal nation. Now, I have here what's called a tribal ID. This proves that my nation recognizes me. Whether you're federally recognized or you're non-federally recognized, you can have tribal ID. Now, back in 2012, December 26, 2012, I founded I Don't Know More in the San Francisco Greater Bay Area. Our group, United Native Americans. Now, I'd like to bring to this attention, because we have some hack running around as a fake wannabe Indian, running around exploiting our community every time she runs out claiming to represent our community to speak. And her name is Penny Opalplant. She is a fake wannabe Indian, and she exploits our people over there at gathering tribes where she's selling our culture, selling our particular sacred items, and this needs to stop. The American Indian Movement has been co-opted for many, many years. They are irrelevant now. They do nothing anymore. Now, there are a number of other groups that are out there that represent indigenous people from the northern tribes. The first was, of course, National Congress of American Indians. They're the oldest and largest group that we have since 1944. Then you have the National Indian Youth Council came up. Then UNA, then AIM. Those are the four main groups that really consist of our indigenous movement. Just because AIM has the nickname American Indian Movement doesn't mean that they represent all of us. Okay? Now, some of the things that we have done as far as through our organization, we founded, of course, the Native American Studies Program during the Third World Strike. We've been going for 45 years, a lot longer than Occupy Movement. Occupy Movement is a little baby compared to what some of the other larger groups that have been established and have developed programs, legislation, and met with our congressional leaders and led huge marches against D.C. Our group was the one who spearheaded the longest walk of 1978, where we defeated 11 bills in Congress and brought us to the attention that they were sterilizing our women and children and using them as guinea pigs for pharmaceutical companies. Now, fast forward to today. Some of the things that we are advocating for as far as for our community, our tribal community here. Now, of course, Masanto. I heard somebody mentioning Masanto earlier. Now, I myself and our group, we, of course, have been campaigning to get the GMOs labeled in the state of California. First through Prop 37, then, of course, SB 1381. Both have, unfortunately, failed up there at the Senate because a lot of those corrupt leaders don't give a shit about us. They want us to eat that junk. They want us to diet. They want us to have non-nutritional food. I'd like to remind each and every one of you that half of the world's food supply came from American Indians. 62% of the world's food supply came from American Indians. Corn, potatoes, and peanuts are the three largest foods that we consumed each and every single day at a majority of our meals each day. But Monsanto, of course, has monopolized our food supply. They're giving us, of course, this GMOs, genetically modified organism that they're injecting into our food supply. Then you look at the oil industry and what they're doing as far as the fracking. Now, say you have a garden here and they come in and they drill an oil well here when they're fracking. Well, what do you think you're going to ingest as far as that food supply? You're going to be eating not just the poison that's in the ground that was injected there through the fracking, but also through the genetically modified organisms that Monsanto and their seeds have contributed to us. That's why you see a lot of obesity, you see our children with autism, and especially in our tribal communities where we live on, we have to live, unfortunately, on GMOs. That's why you see high rates of diabetes and heart disease in our communities and in communities of color and poor all around. The other thing that we've been really advocating for is, of course, the fact that we, as the American Indian community, we helped integrate baseball 48 years before Jackie Robinson came in. We had 30 Indians who actually came into the majors before Jackie Robinson. 30. But we're not recognized as human beings. Just like the 389 treaties that we signed, that is international law. I heard somebody talking about treaties earlier. What about our treaties? What about the land that was stolen from us? We gave away over 1 billion acres of land.
Good.
1 billion acres of land. Every inch of this country, this continent, is stained in Indian blood. We are down to the brink as far as where we're at, as far as the northern tribal community, because of the genocide, the massive genocidal movement that the imperialists came here and wanted to conquer us, enslave us, put us in their boarding schools to whiten us, and all a series of other things. But I'm glad to be here. I'm glad to finally at least be able to talk. And of course, as far as the indigenous community, the real indigenous community, we do have a voice here, and we've been doing it for 45 years. Thank you very much.
These fabulous efforts have failed to unite together and push forth a worldview other than that promoted by the dominant discourse. Instead of seeing us as a larger movement, we operate as disparate pieces. We need a massive popular movement that puts forth a larger worldview of the world that we want, rather than just reacting to what we don't want. We like to say that Martin Luther King Jr. did not motivate hundreds and thousands of people by saying, "I have a complaint." He had a dream, and we at the Network of Spiritual Progressives also have a dream. What the NSP offers is a positive vision of the world we want based on a new bottom line, one that judges the efficacy, rationality, and productivity of our institutions and government and its policies and corporations based not on the old bottom line of whether they maximize money and power, but instead on assessing them to the extent that they maximize love and caring, kindness and generosity, empathy and compassion, social and economic justice, peace and nonviolence, and environmental sustainability, as well as encourage us to transcend our narrow utilitarian approach to nature and each other. We offer this not as a substitute for the good work that we all are already engaged in, but as a way of helping people see that we all are a part of a larger movement that can finally articulate a positive worldview. In fact, doing so will not only bring more people to your specific good project, it will also strengthen our ability to work as allies and continue to feel connected, even when our work does not produce immediate results. I like to think of it this way. Each of the organizations working on different issues are like the spokes of a wheel. The spokes are a critical component of the wheel. They hold up, but they also meet in the middle. And yet, without a hub at the center that unites them, and without a rim that binds the spokes together, there is no wheel. And for a wheel to function as a whole, that means it will move forward. So what is the hub? The hub is the vision of the worldview that we want. And it's a world based on a new bottom line. In fact, I think it's the vision of the world that we all here at Occupy can share. And all of your social change organizations can also share. Yet organizations often don't articulate this worldview. So what is the rim? The rim of the wheel we like to think of as the Network of Spiritual Progressives. We are all connected through these disparate efforts as a unified whole by putting forth this worldview. United in this way, we can move forward together with greater ease and success. So to help activists, we are offering training to learn how to promote your wonderful work from this larger worldview, and also teach activists how to talk with people who do not agree with your perspective in a compassionate way. We also have concrete proposals, such as the Environmental and Social Responsibility Amendments to the U.S. Constitution, which I have with me today, and you can please sign if you feel motivated to do so. But briefly, the ESRA has three main components. First, the amendment overturns Citizens United, declaring that money is not speech and corporations are not people. And it goes a step further, making all national and state elections publicly funded. No other monies would be allowed, whether by corporations, individuals, political parties, PACs, and so on. Secondly, It requires that all corporations with incomes over $50 million a year get a new corporate charter every 5 years. And they can only get that corporate charter if they can prove a satisfactory history of environmental and social responsibility to a panel of ordinary citizens. Thirdly, it requires that environmental responsibility, compassionate communication, and other civic engagement skills be taught in all schools from kindergarten through graduate or professional school. We also promote a domestic and global Marshall Plan that would redirect 1-2% of all the gross domestic product of all industrialized countries to meet the basic needs here and abroad, and to end, finally, once and for all, poverty, homelessness, inadequate health care, and education. The NSP is not only for members of religious communities, but for people who do not believe in God or do not associate with a religious movement in general, but who realize the need for a new bottom line in our society. So how does joining the NSP and collaborating with us help your efforts? Returning to my wheel image, we cannot create a full wheel without all the parts. We will all be more effective in transforming our society and the world if we work together, and that is all why we're here today. We hope that all of your organizations and individuals will join the NSP. Please see me for more information. We're creating a new page on our website where we'd like to promote your work, and if you want to cross-promote our work too, that'd be great. But please see me if you'd like to get involved and if you would like to be featured on our site. Thank you so much for your time and attention. I really believe that we can do this together. If we join forces, we can be strengthened and uplifted by one another. So thank you.
How you doing, folks? My name is Joe. I'm a member of the Oscar Grant Committee. Just briefly so you know who we are and what we represent. Our committee came into existence after the collapse of the nonprofit-based CAPE group, the Committee Against Police Executions, that existed for 3 months right after Oscar was killed. When they disappeared, we picked up the struggle, and all nine of us. But we grew from 9 members to over 200 at one point of the struggle. Consistency, sustainability, commitment. That's what works in the long run. Now, we went on, and I used to work on the waterfront, so I had connections to the longshoremen. We had a major action many of you may know about, and that was October 23rd, 2010. The longshoremen, after hearing Meserly's, what he got, you know, he got wound up getting 2 years for killing Oscar Grant. They were burning. The longshoremen was burning. So they got to me and they said, look, man, we want to do something. I said, well, I want you to do something. Let's do something together. So what we wound up doing is they had a one-day strike for the Oakland area for longshoremen, and we had a rally at what we call Oscar Grant Plaza now, 14th and Broadway, on that day. This is the only labor strike that I know of that has occurred recently in this country as a reaction to police murder. Very significant. No, you didn't see it in the newspaper. Well, guess what? The enemy does not publish stories about their own demise. Surprise, surprise. Come on. So what's going on here now? We participated, the Oscar Grant Committee participated in the demilitarization demonstration denouncing Urban Shield that took place on the 5th of September. Now, I don't know, that was in the paper, so I don't know if you paid attention, but the young people got out there, and boy, they were, you know, they took over the street for an hour, and it was a militant demonstration. It was good. We were part of that demonstration. We supported it, but it's not enough. The slogan that I heard these young people saying disturbed me. They said, yeah, we gonna, y'all get out of Oakland. All right, we ran them out of Oakland. The mayor had said no more. The mayor, all of a sudden, got a fit of conscience and said, I'm not going to sign any more contracts with y'all. But who cares if they're not in Oakland and they go right to Alameda, the city of Alameda? Use your head. Think. Sometimes it's a little nauseating. Think about how they done dumbed us down. Well, the more we delve into Urban Shield, what I suggested to people, and it winds up people did this, since they actually want to co-opt the American people into our own oppression. So they, you know, so the anti-terrorist networks actually invite us to be a part of their madness. And you know, and I know this because I read the reports, you know, where they were actually plotting assassinating Occupy leaders. Yes, they were. I read the reports. So I said, well, hell, if they're going to have the Ku Klux Klan there, they're talking about murdering people, maybe we need to check this out and pay some attention to what's going on with this. So some very serious people actually volunteered with Urban Shield, got on the staff, went in the meetings, took pictures. Shane Bauer, the young man that was arrested in Iraq a few years back, you know, he was working for Mother Jones as a journalist, took pictures and was expelled from the conference. Well, wait a minute, we got a problem with that. They took public money to build that so-called confab. You have a right to know what goes on inside Urban Shield. And you will know, because as you see, we're going to have a forum on October the 10th at Oakland High. Talk to you about it later. Look for it. We got the leaflet for you right now. We have people who were inside and are going to give a report. We put information on the web. This is how we're not going to have a fit and destroy Urban Shield by throwing a rock. This is going to take a sustained effort, because what this is a manifestation of the militarization of the police in America. We already know that the American people are opposed to it. And why? How do I know that? Well, I can tell you, because of the sustained, hardcore resistance that took place in Ferguson, where people stood up to tanks, automatic weapons, pointed directly at women with signs calling for freedom and an end to police brutality. Conservative Americans all over this country saw those images and said, nah, we ain't for that. Well, that's good. And in fact, people like to talk about they're giving all these tanks and stuff to the city government. Well, guess what? It's coming up inside of the city councils. Just recently in San Leandro, they had a meeting, public meeting, city council, talking about whether or not they should have a tank. Well, guess what? People showed up and said, hell no. What do we need a tank for? What do cops need a tank for? We are not powerless victims of anything that comes down the pipe. We can and should resist this, but resistance begins with intelligence, with knowing what actually is going on. Please come to our forum on October the 10th and find out for yourself. Thank you very much. Oh, I'm sorry, one more time. That forum is located, it's Friday, October 10th, 7 o'clock, at the Oakland High School Auditorium. Okay? So please join us. And by the way, if you're interested in the Oscar Grant Committee, our meetings are the first Tuesday of the month at the Neville Proctor Library, 7 o'clock. Thank you very much, folks.
Hi, my name's Steve, and under the pink, the code pink canopy over here, I put together about hundreds of photos in a photo journal of the Occupy movement. It took me 4 months to do, so I invite all of you to take a look at it under the pink canopy. Thanks.
Thank you.
Community quality. But that's not the only thing that's wrong with this economy. We have a new economy, and we have to look at what has created the conditions for this new normal. And we look back in events that took place in the 90s, mass incarceration, the war on drugs. We are now competing with prison industries that are paying 25 cents an hour. The so-called free trade agreements, North America Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, closed down 500,000 good-paying factory jobs in the United States, as well as displacing 2 million people in Mexico off of their lands and out of their livelihood to create the workforces in the maquiladoras along the border. The minimum wage in Mexico is $5 a day. The criminalization of people working in the United States without the proper papers. We saw that in 1986, introduced with the Immigration Reform and Control Act, and then 1996, again, immigration laws to further repress people from the right to work to put bread on the table for their children. Those are workers who are now, while they're fully covered by all federal and state labor laws, but they are in a position of feeling uncertain about asserting those rights on the job because they're told that it's illegal for them to have a job, to be here in the United States working. So if we are not joining together with all of our brothers and sisters from undocumented workers, fighting against the repression that's taking place against workers' rights. And another major event that took place in the 1996 was the change in welfare law, what they call welfare reform, where they put strict time limits on having public assistance, and then without having real job training, forcing a lot of desperate mothers out in the workforce to take whatever kind of low-paying job that they can get. That also has been a major factor in bringing down wages. So if we are not linking together these issues, if we are not connecting the dots, we are not going to be really addressing the wealth disparity and the income inequality in this country. And we need to take actions to fix the broken welfare-to-work system. We have a petition on the back table here to have a community jobs ordinance passed in San Francisco that will transform the welfare-to-work system in San Francisco into a genuine job training program that's a path to living wage jobs. And we see that as having model legislation on the local level that we can then build the movement to spread that around the country. We're not going to wait for Congress to act on this. We're not going to get it through Congress. But we can start getting it passed in county by county across the country. So look for our information on the back table here. And long live Occupy.
Yeah. Long live Occupy.
Mike Zitt.
There's Mike.
And Juliana. And these people are champions of the homeless, and they will talk about that situation. Here's Mike.
Hi, everybody. Just to let you know, we have been occupying Staples out in Berkeley now for 78 days. We have about 10 homeless people, 6 in the back and 4 in the front. We've been maintaining 24-hour info table at both locations, and we are trying to save the Berkeley Post Office from privatization through Staples and through a corrupt Congress and some corrupt House resolutions that have been put out there to ruin the Post Office. So I wanted to let you all know, location is Shattuck at the Ramp, and we are encouraging everybody to come on out because now as the rainy season is approaching, we're coming in this period of necessity of shelter. The homeless people throughout the Bay Area are not going to be able to get inside. There's not enough space. There needs to be some type of system set up so that the homeless can construct their shelters, tents, or whatever shelter they can on public property to protect themselves from the elements. And the reasoning behind this is if you open up any survival book out there, if you're in a disaster situation, the first thing that it says is construct a shelter because you need to get out of the elements. Our society has neglected the most basic needs of the homeless, and we need to stand up. Every day people are dying out there. Every day people are getting sick. People are losing their minds. They don't have what they need to survive. And we need to, as a movement, step up and address this. The occupations are what we're known for. The occupations really show the difference between the low and the high of our society. And we are the only voice that the homeless have right now to actually bring this to attention and actually make a difference in the lives of many thousands of people right now, just in this area alone. The homeless situation is not going to get better. It's only going to get worse. Our economy is not doing good. People are still losing their homes. There is no affordable housing. There is no room in the homeless shelters. They're not opening homeless shelters. They're opening prisons. This is a system that is set up to take advantage of those people that don't have money. And they are using them as slaves. They're using them as cannon fodder. They're using them to keep a system afloat that basically just sucks people dry. And we need to do something about this. Every year, thousands more people, like I said, thousands more people are hitting the streets. And I'm seeing seniors out there. I'm seeing women. I'm seeing people that 20 years ago you would never see on the streets. And this is just something that we, again, we have to do something about. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Juliana, and I'm here to talk to you about homelessness. I never thought it could happen to me. I came from a hardworking but also pretty privileged family, and I was taught that if I got my education and did everything I was supposed to do, it would never happen to me, until it did. But becoming homeless was one of the best things that ever happened to me, because that experience opened my eyes and taught me so much about humanity and compassion and the world we live in and the way our society treats and values people. Human beings are the only species on Earth who have to constantly justify their right to exist. Our society only values individuals for their labor and ability to produce. If you are unable to contribute to the labor force, we deny you your basic needs for survival: food, shelter, clothing, healthcare, and education. And those who have often feel entitled and judge those who don't as unworthy or undeserving. People don't realize that homelessness can happen to anybody. We forget that we are all human beings. Every person is someone's son or daughter, a brother or a sister. We would want people to have compassion and help our loved ones, but as a society, we are so hesitant to offer help and so eager to question why it is they need help, so that we can be the judge of whether or not they are worthy.
How you doing?
We live in a world of abundance, producing many times the amount of food needed to feed the Earth's population, yet people still go hungry. Houses sit empty while men, women, children, veterans, the elderly, and disabled wander the streets, and that's not okay. How is it that there's so much suffering? How is it that people have to go without shelter, safety, and security? Homelessness is a dangerous and tragic symptom of a sick and failing system. The way homeless people are being targeted and criminalized in America is a human rights issue. From the inhumane sit-and-lie law used to target people seeking a place to rest during the day, from San Francisco's Penal Code 647E, which prohibits illegal structures and lodging, used to confiscate people's blankets and sleeping bags, the criminalization of the poor and the homeless has become rampant in the U.S. They've made it illegal to distribute food and water under the guise of public health and safety, and often require permits that many nonprofits cannot afford. The homeless are targeted and attacked by DPW using water cannons to torture them. And these are just some examples of the human rights violations that are happening right here in San Francisco that are used to harass and persecute the poor and the homeless. Many people don't care about homeless issues unless they are either homeless themselves or know someone and have friends who are. But the way our society treats those who have the least and need the most help is a clear indication of what is to come. They first bully the weak, the vulnerable, and those who dare to challenge their ways. Benjamin Franklin said that justice will not be served until those who are unaffected are as outraged as those who are. First they came for the homeless, and they'll be coming for you next. So let us stand up together and fight for human rights before it's too late. Thank you.
In Gaza, when we think of all the children who died and who suffered as a result of our wars, many of us already know about the role Monsanto has played in Agent Orange. and the military industrial complex. Well, I'm going to talk to you just for a moment about the food industrial complex and how killing us quickly or killing us slowly, the killing is taking place. We're talking about atrazine. We're talking about dioxin. We're talking about the nearly 200 chemicals, industrial chemicals, that are found in every American baby's cord blood. Before they take their first breath of air, they have absorbed over 187 industrial chemicals. In Europe, if you were to go on a little trip to Amsterdam and someone tried to feed your kids trans fat, you know, the stuff that they fry McDonald's French fries in, the stuff that's in almost every school lunch, if they tried to do that, that's a crime in the Netherlands. That is a criminal offense because it's feeding somebody something that is not food, that may look and smell like food, but the scientists have told us kills people. It kills them slowly. So when we think about occupying our hearths, our gardens, we need to debunk the nutraceutical false advertising campaigns that we're told about what's good for us. When someone says, drink that glass of milk, can I tell you what I don't like about milk without being subject to ag-gag laws? Will I get sued? Do we hear commercials on the radio and on TV all the time telling us how good milk is, telling kids how good milk is for them? Well, what's in it? So we need to think critically about more than just the killing us quickly, but also the killing us slowly. And we have to demand clean food, clean air, clean water, and access to that clean food, clean air, and clean water for everyone, because those belong to all of us. Those belong to all of us. Those are our human rights. So thanks for listening. Happy Peace Day, y'all.